Let us continue again. So now we have seen the concept of a dense subset. Now I will introduce another concept that turns out to be closely related to what we have here. So let me just write it down first, and then we can discuss what it means. So again, we start with a norm vector space. And let's again take a subset that we will denote by W. So observe that we do not ask for this to be a subspace. It is just enough that it is a subset. Also, like we had here, we did not ask for W to be a subspace. It was enough that it's a subset. So it does not need to be a vector space by itself. Then we will define the concept of closure of this subset. So this is the new concept, the closure of W. And let's put in the name for it. So the closure is a new subset, and it will be denoted by, again, W, but then with a bar on the top of it. So you might think this is confusing because this is the same notation you use as for the complex conjugate of a number, but you will always see that in the context it will be clear whether we are speaking about the closure of a subset space or we are looking at the complex conjugate of a number. So in practice, you will never get confused with that. So the closure of the space, this is a set that consists of all the elements V in our space, V, that can be approximated arbitrarily well by elements in W. So the closure consists of all elements in V that can be approximated arbitrarily well by elements in W. What this means is it consists of exactly the elements V in V with the property that for any given epsilon, can find some element W in W such that the norm difference between V and W is smaller than or equal to epsilon. So just by looking at this, you can see that this is extremely close in formulation to what we have here. It's almost the same. So we come back to that in just a minute. Before we do that, let's just give a small example. So remember the concept of the closure of a subset of R. This is something that we already have dealt with in the very first lecture of this course. So in a special case, we have seen this concept of closure of a set. So let's see how this relates to the abstract definition we have here. So let's consider V to be the vector space, the real numbers. And as this doubled U, let's take just an open interval from a number A up to a number B. And then we want to find out what is the closure of W. And from what we did in the very first week of the course, we know that the closure of the set should be what we get just by adding the two endpoints. So we know the outcome should be the closed interval going from A to B. But let's see how this fits with the definition. So let's make a small figure. Let's say that here we have the number A, here we have the number B. So W is everything that is in between here. And then the question is, which elements should be in the closure? So for example, let's start by looking at elements that are inside the interval from A to B. So the question is, if I pick any x sitting in the interval from A to B, should it be contained in the closure of the set if you take an element here, is it in the closure of the set? And the answer is yes, because for this given element, then we can just take W to be itself, then this distance will be equal to zero, and therefore smaller than or equal to any epsilon. So that means all the elements inside here, they are certainly also in the closure of the set. So what about the two endpoints? Will the point A be in the closure of the set? And again, the answer is yes, because if you take our element V to be this, then according to the definition, the question is, can we find W's such that the norm between V and W is smaller than or equal to epsilon? And we can do that, because no matter which epsilon we are giving, if you're taking an epsilon of this size, then we just pick an element inside W that is sufficiently close to the endpoint. So that means this element can be approximated arbitrarily well by elements from inside the set. So certainly the two endpoints should be contained in the closure. So the only thing we need to analyze now will be the points that are outside. So if I take any x outside here, will this be in the closure? Now the answer is no, because this element that is sitting here cannot be arbitrarily well approximated by elements that are inside the set itself, because there's this gap between them. So this argument, together with the definition, tells us that the closure is indeed exactly what we know, namely the closed interval from A to B. Now, I would like to connect the two definitions that we have here. And actually, what comes out here is a lemma. Which says that the property we have up here, namely that a subset W is dense, in V. So what does it mean that W is dense in V? This means that any element in V can be approximated arbitrarily well by elements sitting in W. What this concept says is that the closure of W is exactly the set of elements that can be approximated arbitrarily well by elements in W. So to say that W is dense in V is exactly the same as to say that the closure of W is equal to all the elements in V. So that means this approximation concept that is at the core of what we are speaking about today at the lecture can be formulated in two different ways. Either we speak about having a set which is dense in V, or we speak about having a set with the property that the closure is equal to all of V. So let's go back and connect that to the theorems that we got today. So we still have the theorem 542 here. That was the one that said that the continuous function with compact support are dense in the LP spaces. So we can take that, and then we can say this is formulated like this, but now we can combine it with a lemma and say this can be formulated by saying that the closure of the set of continuous functions with compact support is equal to LP. So via this theorem and our new lemma, we obtain that if you look at C, C, R, and then we take the closure of this, we get LP of R. And this is something that happened for all P. We have to take the same restrictions as we took up here. So this is for the P's that belong in the interval from 1 up to infinity. Now, I think if it was me who was sitting here, I would actually get confused about this statement, because there's something that does not look right. You see, here on the right-hand side, you have something that depends on the P. There's no P here. In other words, this does not seem to have anything to do with the P. So how can it be at the same time be equal to L1 and L2 and any other of the LP spaces? So what is the reason that it is not wrong what I wrote here? Christian?
Since it has complex support, it's not really matter which norm you take it with respect to. I mean, isn't that the defining property of the LP spaces? It's the norm.
I am not 100% sure that I understand what you mean, but are you saying that this closure means something different?
No, I'm saying that this is possible because the only thing that changes with the P in the LP space is the norm.
So you say the only thing that changes with the P is the norm. This is correct. So when we say that the set of continuous functions is dense in LP, what this means is exactly what we wrote down here, that given any f in LP, we can find a continuous function with compact support such that this difference is smaller than or equal to epsilon. But now we want to formulate that in terms of the closure. And when we just write closure like this, we don't really see any norm, we don't really see any P at the moment. So why is it still correct?
Each of the possible norms in from LP.
So this is correct what you say now, that what we are saying here is we are taking the closure, but we always take the closure with respect to a given norm. That means we start by fixing the P and we say maybe we want to look at the space L2. Then what this statement says is that if you take the continuous functions with compact support and we take the closure of that with respect to the L2 norm, then we get the space L2. This is what you see here also in the definition. The closure. When you speak about the closure of a set, it is always with respect to the norm that you have on this space, because this is the norm that we're putting in here. So that means, even though I just put the bar, then this bar actually means something different for different values of P. So you know, Germans, they are always very exact in their notation. So in German literature, you actually see a more careful formulation of this. So the Germans will write that we take the space CCR, and then we take the closure, but we take the closure with respect to the LP norm. So they will write the closure, and then they write norm, and then P, and say this is equal to the space LP of R. And now you see, now there's a P on both sides, and now everything makes sense. I didn't put this in the book, I just write the closure, and this is actually standard to do it without this extra notation, but this is what will make everything completely exact, to put that also. I think we should do the same for the sequence space. So we had a lemma saying that if you look at the finite sequences, they are dense in any of the sequence spaces, LP. So that lemma was the 3.24. So if you take that, and then we combine it with the one we have here, then we get that this sequence space, the space of finite sequences, so the set of xk, k from 1 to infinity, for which only a finite number of xk's are non-zero. So if you take this space, then we have seen that this is dense in the space LP. So this space is dense in LP, and according to what we have here, this means exactly that the closure of this space is equal to LP, and this is again for p greater than or equal to 1 and less than infinity. And again, the reason that this can happen for all values of p is, here we have the p, but when we speak about the closure, this is always with respect to the norm on the space LP. So we have the p also here, even though I did not write it on the board. Do you have any questions about this approximation theory? Okay. Then I will show you a case where we need it. So the way I formulate it today will be as a purely mathematical statement. But what we'll see next week when we speak about the Fourier transform is that we actually need it in practice. So the idea behind the statement I'll write down now is that if you want to define an operator on a complicated space, sometimes it is much easier to define the operator on an easier subspace. So for example, if you want to define an operator acting on any of the LP spaces, sometimes it is much easier just to define it on continuous functions with compact support. And it turns out that there's a way first to define an operator on a subspace and then extend the operator to the full space later on. The same happens if you want to define an operator on a sequence space, like for example L1. So you know the sequence space L1, this is the sequences for which, when you look at the absolute value of xk and you make the sum over all k, you get something finite. So it's more or less clear that if you want to define an operator on such a space, you will always have to deal with convergence issues, because the elements you are putting into the operator are defined in terms of an infinite series that should be convergent. So that means if you define such an operator, you get automatically some convergence issues to deal with. But if you don't look at the space L1, but instead just look at this dense subspace, then you can say, but this just consists of sequences that are non-zero. That means when you put finite sequences into an operator, you usually don't have to deal with any convergence issues. So that means it would be much easier to define an operator just acting on the space we have here, and then after doing that, extend it to L1. And this is exactly the idea behind the theorem that I'll put down for you now. So what I'll tell you now is that there's a way to say, we look at an operator that is defined on a subset of something, and then how can we extend it to an operator on the full space? So there's no mistake in the way it is formulated in the book, but actually there's an assumption in the theorem that is not necessary. So what I'll do now is to formulate the theorem exactly as it is in the book, and then we give the proof of the theorem, and then after that, of course, I'll ask you, where is the assumption that we can remove? That's one of them that we don't need. So we are still moving around in the book. So now we are at theorem 3.2.2. And what it says is, we pick two arbitrary Banach spaces. And the idea is that we would like to define a bounded linear operator going from V1 into V2. But we think about it in the way that V1 might be a very complicated space, and therefore we first define the operator on a subspace. So we take a dense subspace of V1, And then we assume that in some way we have been able to define a bounded linear operator mapping this subspace into V2. So we have given an operator T that goes from W into V2, and we know that this is a bounded linear operator. Then what the theorem will tell us is that we can take this operator, which is just defined on a Denton subspace, and then we can extend it to an operator that is defined on the full space. And in fact, it can be done, and it can be done in exactly one way. So in other words, this operator has a unique extension to an operator on the full space. So we can, in a unique way, make an extension of T to a bounded linear operator. And now, because it is an extension of T, I will denote it by something else. So I'll call it T and then with a tilde on the top. And this should now be an operator on the full space. So that means we replace the W by the space V1, and it should still map into V2. So I think I need to tell you exactly what do I mean by an extension of an operator. So by making an extension of something, this means that if you look at this new operator and we put in something where already the first operator makes sense, that means we put in some elements that are already in the space W, then the two operators should give us the same value. So in other words, what the theorem tells us is that there exists a unique operator So a unique bounded linear operator, so T tilde going from V1 into V2, there is a unique such operator that is an extension of the T. And to be an extension of T means that if you put in something into T tilde that also makes sense for the T, then they should give the same value. So that means if you put in some V where V belongs to the space W, then the outcome should be the same whether we take T tilde or we take the T. So these are two different ways of formulating exactly the same. Let's see how we can prove this. So you see, what we want to do is to define T tilde as an operator from V1 into V2. So what this means is you should give me some elements V that belongs to V1, and then what I should be able to do for you is to tell what should be the action T tilde on this element V. So the first problem, or the key problem, is how to define T tilde of V. So what we'll do is You'll find a way to define T tilde of V, and then after having the definition of T tilde V, then we have to check all the properties. So we have to check that it is a bounded operator, that it is a linear operator, and we have to check that it is an extension of the operator T. So we have to use the properties that are given. So we look at an element in V1, but the assumption is that W is a dense subspace of V1. So according to our definition, this means that arbitrary elements in V1 can be approximated arbitrarily well by elements in W. So in other words, we can find a sequence of elements in this space that converts to the given V. So by density of W in V1, there is a sequence which we'll call WK, K from 1 to infinity, a sequence of elements in W such that WK converts to this given elements V. I would like to make a small calculation for you. Let's look at what is the T acting on the WK minus the T acting on some other elements in the sequence, which could be called W with an index L. So our operator is linear. So this is the same as the norm of, and then we can just put these together. We can write as T acting on the difference WK minus WL. And now, because our operator is bounded, then we know that the norm of T acting on something is smaller than or equal to just the norm of the operator times the norm of the vector. And now the vector is WK minus WL. So what we know about this sequence, WK, is that this is convergent. But maybe you remember from the beginning of the course that if a sequence is convergent, it has another property. It is a Cauchy sequence also. So the sequence is convergent, and therefore it is a Cauchy sequence. So we did not use Cauchy sequences so much in the course, but you can see this is actually the lemma 3.1.3 that we have here. It says if you have any sequence which is convergent, then it is automatically a Cauchy sequence. So what does it mean to have something that is a Cauchy sequence? So if you just look at what it means that WK is a Cauchy sequence, this means that the norm difference between WK and WL can be smaller than or equal to an arbitrary number epsilon just by taking K and L to be sufficiently large. This is our definition of a Cauchy sequence. So what this says is that therefore TWK must also be a Cauchy sequence, because the difference between TWK, TWL is smaller than or equal to this, which will be arbitrarily small for K and L sufficiently large, times just a factor. So that means the estimate we have here tells us that also the TWK will be a Cauchy sequence. So by our estimate, so when I say estimate, then I mean the inequality we have here. Also, the TWK from K equal to 1 to infinity is a Cauchy sequence. But a Cauchy sequence in which space? The T, where does it map to? This is what we see here. T takes elements in W and maps them into V2. So this means now we have a Cauchy sequence and it takes place in the space W2. But W2 is a Banach space. We have assumed that V2 is a Banach space. And to be a Banach space means exactly that no matter which Cauchy sequence you take, you know that it is convergent. So because this is a Banach space, then we know that this sequence is convergent. So here we just use the definition of a Banach space. Now what we want to do is to define the T tilde. So we need to define T tilde of V. This was the problem that we had up here. And the way we will define it is to say we know that this sequence is convergent, and we define T tilde of V simply to be the limit for K going to infinity, T of WK. So actually, what happened here, it looked very confusing, I guess, the way it is stated here. But if you just look at it at a little distance, you can see that it makes good sense. Because what happened is, we take this arbitrary element V belonging to V1. Maybe I should make the picture here. We take this arbitrary element V belonging to our space, and we want to define the operator acting on this. What we did is to take a sequence WK such that WK converts to the V. Now the question is, how can we define T tilde of V? What we do is we just take the T acting on these, and what the argument says is that this sequence is actually convergent, and then it converts to something. And this something is what we will denote by T tilde of V. So actually, if you look at it this way, the definition that I have stated here makes good sense. But now what we have to do is to check that the operator actually has all the properties that we have stated. So let's do that. So the first point is to check T tilde is linear. And this is actually a little bit complicated, what we have to do now. It's a little bit like some weeks ago, where we had to define the adjoint of a certain operator. And you had this problem that Mass described very well, saying that you never really see how the adjoint is. You just have the information that the adjoint operator must satisfy that two inner products are equal all the time. And then you have to manipulate on that, and then you can, at the end, find the adjoint. You are in a little bit the similar situation here, because the operator T tilde is just defined by a complex expression like this. That means in order to work with the operator T tilde, you have to run through this entire procedure. That means in order to define T tilde on a given element V, you have to take a sequence of W that converts to V, and then you have to look at the limit we have here. So that means what we want to show now is that T tilde of some alpha V plus W, alpha V plus B W, this should be the same as alpha T tilde V plus beta T tilde W. And the only way you can do this is to say, okay, this is something we can calculate by replacing V by some elements W that converts to V. And again here, this element has to be replaced by a sequence converting to the element, and then we use the definition. So it is bound to be complicated, what we are doing now. We have to run through the entire procedure that I have described here. So we have to give the argument. So we say, we take a sequence that converts to the V, so we take a sequence of elements VK in W such that VK converts to V, and we also take a sequence WK, K equals 1 to infinity in W, such that WK converts to the W. So by taking these two sequences, then we can write down what we have here, and we can write down what we have here. We still have a problem with this, because what about a sequence converting to alpha V plus beta W? But fortunately, we can construct that using what we have here, because a consequence of VK convergence to V and WK convergence to W is that if you look at alpha VK plus beta WK, then the rules for limits will say that this converts to alpha times the V plus beta times the W. So that means if you want to calculate what we have here, T tilde of alpha V plus beta W, then in order to use our definition, we have to take a sequence that converts to this element, and then we have to run exactly the procedure that is described here. But we can do that because this is a sequence of elements that converts to alpha V plus beta W. So according to the definition of T tilde, then this is the same as the limit for K going to infinity, and then we do exactly what is stated here. We take the T acting on the sequence converting to the element. So here we have the T tilde, here we just have the T, and then we put in the sequence, which is then alpha VK plus beta WK. But now we can do some manipulations, because T is by assumption a linear operator. That means T acting on a linear combination is something that can be split out. So now we use that T is linear. And then we get, this is the same as the limit for K going to infinity. And then when we use the linearity here, this is alpha T V K plus beta T W K. But how does the limit act on a sum of some terms or on a linear combination? This is again something we know. This is just, linearity of the limit. So this is the same as alpha times the limit for k going to infinity of t vk plus beta times the limit for k going to infinity of t w. Okay, and the question is, do we know something now? Andreas?
Yes, now you know that start calculation, then you have shown now the alpha times t tilde v plus beta.
So you say this is equal to t tilde of v?
Yeah.
And this is t tilde of W. And why? This is again because of the definition. VK is chosen such that it converts to V. That means, by definition, we have that the t tilde of v is the limit of t of, and then the sequence is, its name is not wk now, it is vk. So this is exactly what we have here. And the wk converts to the w, and therefore this is our definition of t tilde of w. So this is correct. What about t being bounded? This is the second thing we have to show. Or not t being bounded, but t tilde being bounded. So again, we need to look at some element in the space V1, and in order to work with this space, we need to find a sequence of elements in W that converts to it. So we take the sequence such that VK converts to V. And then we want to calculate T tilde acting on the V. And then at the end of the day, we should get that this is smaller or equal to some constant times the norm of V. So again, by definition, now we again refer to exactly what is stated here, but now again, the sequence is not WK, it is VK. So this is the same as the limit of k going to infinity, and then t without a tilde acting on vk. And the question is, how would you like to manipulate this? And I think what would disturb me would be the limit. So I will find a slide to show you, but while I do that, do any of you have an idea how to continue from here? So, as always, there's some tricky example or exercise somewhere in the curriculum that will give the answer to this question. We had an exercise long time ago, exercise 2.1, and what it says is that if you take any sequence VK that converts to some element V, then it also holds that the norm of VK converts to the norm of V. That means what we showed is that the limit of VK is the same as the norm of the V. But if you put in what the V is the limit of the VK. So if I put it in instead of the V, then it is equal to the norm of the limit VK. So actually what this statement says us is that if you have the norm and you have the limit inside, this is the same as the limit outside and then the norm of the VK. This is probably not the way you thought about it at the time you did this exercise, but this is exactly what it tells us. So this means this limit that disturbs us here, we can apply it not on the sequence VK, but we can apply it on the T VK. So this is exercise 2.1 applied to T VK. According to this, we can just take the limit outside and say this is the limit for k going to infinity, and then we have the norm of T VK. And can anybody tell me how can we continue from here? Bjorn?
This must be less than or equal to the limit of the norm of T.
This is less than or equal to the limit of, and then you say norm of T times the norm of VK. And this is correct, because here We don't have anything to do with T tilde. This is just the operator T, and the assumption is that T is linear and bounded. So that means the norm of T acting on something is smaller than or equal to the norm of T times the norm of Vk. So this is exactly the assumption that we have here. T acting on this subspace is a bounded operator. So this is just the assumption. So we can write that here also. This is because T is bounded. And now we can do exactly the same trick again. We can say the norm of T, this is just a number. So what we have here is just the limit of the norm Vk as k goes to infinity. But according to exactly the same exercise, so this is again exercise 2.1, this is the same as the norm of limit Vk, k going to infinity. And Vk is chosen such that it converts to V, that means the limit Vk, k going to infinity, this is just the V. So that means if we read from here, what the statement says is that for arbitrary elements V, the norm of T tilde V is smaller than or equal to the norm of T times the norm of V. So this tells us that the operator T tilde is bounded. So let's check how far we are with the program. So what we have done is that for sure we have defined an operator T tilde going from V1 into V2. And we have also checked that it is bounded and that it is linear. So the only thing we have not checked is that this is really an extension of T. So we'll just use one board to do that, and then we conclude for today. So can anybody help to find out how can we show that T tilde is an extension of T? So that T tilde is an extension of T means exactly what we stated here, namely that in case we put in something that also makes sense for the operator T, then the outcome should be the same. So in other words, if you take elements in W, then T tilde V should be the same as T of V. So how can we check that? Kasper?
If you take T tilde acting on some V, then if V is a W,
exactly. So what you say is that what we should do here is to check that T tilde V is the same as T of V for all V in W. So let's take a V that is in W. Then we can just take as this sequence Vk, we can just take Vk equal to V for all k, this will satisfy that Vk, because it is equal to V all the time, we can also say it converts to V as k goes to infinity. So this means that T tilde acting on the V, again by definition, we still have the definition here, this is the limit as k goes to infinity of T acting on Vk, but all the Vk's are chosen just to be the V, so this is the limit for k going to infinity of T on the V. And there's no dependence on k here, so this is just the same as T of V. So what it says is, take an arbitrary element V belonging to our subspace, then T tilde on that element is exactly the same as T on the element. So this proves that T tilde is indeed an extension of T. So what we will do next week is actually to make an application of this theorem, because the topic for next week will be the Fourier transform. Some of you will know the Fourier transform, some of you have not seen it before. But it turns out that we will always use the Fourier transform in the together with the other operators we have defined. That means together with translation, modulation, and the scaling. But the problem is that when we define the Fourier transform, we will actually define it as an operator on L1. But all the other operators we are dealing with are defined on L2. So that means we somehow have to make some changes on the Fourier transform such that it starts with something on L1 and then we extend it to L2. And the technical way to do that will be exactly as I described today, to say if the Fourier transform is defined on L1, then it is also defined on the continuous functions with compact support, because they're just a subspace of L1. So that means we look at the Fourier transform defined on the set of continuous functions with compact support. And then it turns out that on this space, so if you think about it, that I could make it with some colors so you can get an idea about what I'll do next week. So the Fourier transform will be something we denote with an F, and then the space we have here will be the continuous function with compact support, and the space we are dealing with here will be L2 of R, and also this space will be L2 of R. So you can see that it fits exactly, that we are looking at the Fourier transform, and we are looking at a certain dense subspace, and then we can actually extend it to an operator on all of L2. So this is what we'll do the next week. But before I let you go, I just remembered that I asked you a question, and I forgot it again. Which assumption didn't we use in the theorem? There's an assumption stated up there that we actually never used. Alexandra? Yes, so what did you use about V1? Can it just be any vector space, or do we need something for V1?
Well, W has to be a dense subspace of V1.
So what do you need about V1? It's true, W has to be a dense subspace of V1, but what do we need about V1? We do not need that it is a Banach space, but can it just be a vector space? It must be a norm vector space, because we work with a norm all the time. So that means we could actually extend this theorem and say V2 has to be a Banach space, because we work with QC sequences in this space. But V1, it is actually enough that this is just a norm vector space. It is not necessary that V1 is a Banach space. Okay, let's meet at the exercises.